Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of In Plain Sight by C.J. Box, narrated by David Chandler, and directed by Danny Snelson. This book is copyrighted 2008 by C.J. Box. This recording is copyrighted 2008 by Recorded Books. When wealthy matriarch Opal Scarlett vanishes, Wyoming fish and game warden Joe Pickett is sure one of her greedy sons did her in. But when Joe becomes the victim of increasingly wicked and violent pranks, he wonders if what's happening has less to do with Opal's disappearance than with the darkest chapter of his own past. And now, In Plain Sight.
April. F. Scott Fitzgerald said, "Family quarrels are bitter things. They don't go by any rules. They're not like aches or wounds. They're more like splits in the skin that won't heal because there's not enough material." O.E. Rolvag, in The Giants in the Earth, wrote, "The Great Plain drinks the blood of Christian men and is satisfied." Chapter 1, 12 Sleep County, Wyoming. When ranch owner Opal Scarlett vanished, no one mourned except her three grown sons, Arlen, Hank, and Wyatt, who expressed their loss by getting into a fight with shovels. Wyoming game warden Joe Pickett almost didn't hear the call over his radio when it came over the mutual aid channel. He was driving west on Bighorn Road, having picked up his 14-year-old daughter Sheridan and her best friend Julie after track practice to take them home. Sheridan and Julie were talking a mile a minute, gesticulating, making his dog Maxine flinch with their flying arms as they talked. Julie lived on the Thunderhead Ranch, which was much farther out of town than the Pickett's home. Joe caught snippets of their conversation while he drove, his attention on his radio and the wounded hum of the engine and the dancing gauges on the dash. Joe didn't yet trust the truck, a vehicle recently assigned to him. The check engine light would flash on and off, and occasionally there was a knocking sound under the hood that sounded like popcorn popping. The truck had been issued to him as revenge by his cost-conscious superiors, after his last vehicle had burned up in a fire in Jackson Hole. Even though the suspension was shot, the truck did have a CD player, a rarity in state vehicles, and the soundtrack for the ride home had been a CD Sheridan had made for him. It was titled "Get With It, Dad," in a black felt marker. She'd given it to him 2 days before, after breakfast, saying, "You need to listen to this new music so you don't seem so clueless. It may help." Things were changing in his family. His girls were getting older. Joe was not only under the thumb of his superiors, but was apparently becoming clueless, too. His red uniform shirt with the pronghorn antelope game and fish patch on the shoulder and his green Filson vest were caked with mud from changing a tire on the mountain earlier in the day. "I think Jared Haynes likes you," Julie said to Sheridan. "Get out! Why do you say that? You're crazy." "Didn't you see him watching us at practice?" Julie asked. "He stayed after the boys were done and watched us run." "I saw him," Sheridan said, "but why do you think he likes me?" "'Cause he didn't take his eyes off of you the whole time, that's why. Even when he got a call on his cell, he stood there and watched you while he talked. He's hot for you, Sherry." "I wish I had a cell phone," Sheridan said. Joe tuned out. He didn't want to hear about a boy targeting his daughter. It made him uncomfortable. And the cell phone conversation made him tired. He and Mary Beth had said Sheridan wouldn't get one until she was 16, but that didn't stop his daughter from coming up with reasons why she needed one now. In the particularly intense way of teenage girls, Sheridan and Julie were inseparable. Julie was tall, lithe, tanned, blonde, blue-eyed, and budding. Sheridan was a shorter version of Julie, but with her mother's startling green eyes. The two had ridden the school bus together for years, and Sheridan had hated Julie, said she was bossy and arrogant and acted like royalty. Then something happened, and the two girls could barely be apart from each other. 3-hour phone calls between them weren't unusual at night. "I just don't know what to think about that," Sheridan said. "You'll be the envy of everyone if you go with him," Julie said. "He doesn't seem very smart." Julie laughed and rolled her eyes. "Who cares?" she said. "He's freaking awesome." Joe cringed, wishing he had missed that. He had spent the morning patrolling the brushy foothills where the spring wild turkey season was still open, although there appeared to be no turkey hunters about. It was his first foray into the timbered southwestern saddle slopes since winter. The snow was receding up the mountain, leaving hard-packed, grainy drifts in arroyos and cuts. The retreating snow also revealed the aftermath of small battles and tragedies no one had witnessed that had taken place over the winter. 6 mule deer that had died of starvation in a wooded hollow. A cow and calf elk that had broken through the ice on a pond and frozen in place. Pronghorn antelope caught in the barbed wire of a fence, their emaciated bodies draping over the wire like rugs hanging to dry. But there were signs of renewal as well, as thick, light green shoots bristled through dead matted grass near stream sides, and fat, pregnant does stared at his passing pickup from shadowed groves. April was the slowest month of the year in the field for a game warden, especially in a place with a fleeting spring. It was the 5th year of a drought. The hottest issue he had to contend with was what to do with the 4 elk that had shown up in the town of Saddle String and seemed to have no plans to leave. While mule deer were common in the parks and gardens, elk were not. Joe had chased the 4 animals, 2 bulls, a cow, and a calf, from the city park several times by firing 22 blanks into the air several times, but they kept coming back. The animals had become such a fixture in the park they were now referred to as the town elk, and locals were feeding them, which kept them hanging around, while providing empty nourishment that would eventually make them sick and kill them. Joe was loath to destroy the elk, but thought he may not have a choice if they stuck around. The changes in his agency had begun with the election of a new governor. On the day after the election, Joe had received a 4-word message from his supervisor, Trey Crump, that read, "Hell has frozen over," meaning a Democrat had been elected. His name was Spencer Rulon. Within a week, the agency director resigned before being fired, and a bitter campaign was waged for a replacement. Joe and most of the game wardens actively supported an anybody but Randy Pope ticket, since Pope had risen to prominence within the agency from the administrative side rather than the law enforcement or biology side, and made no bones about wanting to rid the state of personnel he felt were too independent, who had gone native, or were considered uncontrollable cowboys, men like Joe Pickett. Joe's clash with Pope the year before in Jackson had resulted in a simmering feud that was heating up, as Joe's report of Pope's betrayal made the rounds within the agency, despite Pope's efforts to stop it. Governor Rulon was a big man with a big face and a big gut, an unruly shock of silver-flecked brown hair, a quick, sloppy smile, and endlessly darting eyes. In the previous year's election, Rulon had beaten the Republican challenger by 20 points, despite the fact that his opponent had been handpicked by term-limited Governor Budd. This in a state that was 70% Republican. Rulon grew up on a ranch near Casper, the grandson of a U.S. senator. He played linebacker for the Wyoming Cowboys, got a law degree, made a fortune in private practice suing federal agencies, then was elected county prosecutor. Loud and profane, Rulon campaigned for governor by crisscrossing the state endlessly in his own pickup and buying rounds for the House in every bar from Yoder to Wright, and challenging anyone who didn't plan to vote for him to an arm wrestling, sports trivia, or shooting contest. The word most used to describe the new governor seemed to be energetic. He could turn from a good old boy pounding beers and slapping backs into an orator capable of delivering the 12-minute closing argument by Spencer Tracy in Inherit the Wind from memory. His favorite breakfast was reportedly biscuits and sausage gravy and a glass of Pinot Noir. Like Wyoming itself, Joe thought, Rulon didn't mind leading with his rough exterior and later surprising and mildly troubling the onlooker with a kind of eccentric depth. He was also, according to more and more state employees who had to deal with their new boss, crazy as a tick. But he was profoundly popular with the voters. Unlike his predecessor, Rulon reassigned his bodyguards to the highway patrol, fired his driver, and insisted that his name and phone number be listed in the telephone book. He eliminated the gatekeepers who had been employed to restrict access to his office and put up a sign that said, "Gov Rulon's office, barge right in," which was heeded by an endless stream of visitors. One of Rulon's first decisions was to choose a new game and fish director. The Board of Commissioners lined up a slate of three candidates, Pope included. The governor's first choice was a longtime game warden from Medicine Bow, who died of a heart attack within a week of the announcement. The second candidate withdrew his name from consideration when news of an old sexual harassment suit hit the press, which left Randy Pope, who gladly assumed the role, even declaring to a reporter that fate and destiny both stepped forward to enable his promotion. That had been 2 months ago. Trey Crump, Joe's district supervisor, said he saw the writing on the wall and took early retirement rather than submit to Pope's new directives for supervisors. Without Trey, who had also been Joe's champion within the state bureaucracy, Joe now had been ordered to report directly to Pope. Instead of weekly reports, Pope wanted daily dispatches. It was Pope who had nixed Joe's request for a new pickup, and instead had sent one with 150,000 miles on it, bald tires, and a motor that was unreliable. Joe had been around long enough to know exactly what was happening. Pope could not appear to have a public vendetta against Joe, especially because Joe's star had risen over the past few years in certain quarters. But Pope was a master of the bureaucratic death of a thousand cuts, the slow, steady, petty, and maddening procedure. Misplaced requests, unreturned phone calls, lost insurance and reimbursement claims, blizzards of busy work, designed to drive an employee out of a state or federal agency. And with Pope, Joe knew it was personal. "Dad?" Joe realized Sheridan was talking to him.
"What?"
"How can he tune out like that?" Julie asked Sheridan, as if Joe weren't in the cab. "I don't know. It's amazing, isn't it?" Then, "Dad, are we going to stop and feed Nate's birds? I want to show Julie the falcons."
"I already fed them today," he said.
"Darn." Joe slowed and turned onto a dirt road from the highway beneath a massive elk antler arch with a sign hanging from chains that read, "Thunderhead Ranches, established 1883. The Scarletts, Opal, Arlen, Hank, Wyatt." Julie said, "My grandma says someday my name is going to be on that sign."
"Cool," Sheridan replied. Joe had heard Julie say that before.
Even though Joe had seen the Thunderhead Ranch in bits and pieces over the years, he was still amazed by its magnificence. There were those he knew who would drive the scores of old two-tracks on the ranch and look around and see miles and miles of short grass, sagebrush, and rolling hills, and compare the place poorly with much more spectacular alpine country. Sure, the river bottom was lush, and the foothills rose in a steady march toward the Bighorns and were dotted with trees, but the place wouldn't pop visually for some, because it was just so open, so big, so sprawling. But that was the thing. Because of the river, because of the confluence of at least 5 significant creeks that coursed through the property and poured into the 12 Sleep River, because of the optimum diversification of landscape within 1,000 square miles, and the vast meadows of thick, nutrient-enriched grass, the Thunderhead was the perfect cattle ranch. Joe had once heard a longtime rancher and resident of the county, Herbert Klein, say that if aliens landed and demanded to see a dog, he would show them a Labrador. And if they demanded to see a ranch, he would skip his own and show them the Thunderhead. It was also an ideal ranch for wildlife, which posed an opportunity for Hank, who ran an exclusive hunting business, and a problem for Joe Pickett. "Look," Sheridan said, sitting up. A herd of pronghorn antelope, a liquid flow of brown and white, streamed over a knoll ahead of them and to the right, raising dust and heading for a collision with the pickup. "They don't see us yet," Joe said, marveling, as always, at the graceful but raw speed of the antelope, the second fastest mammal on Earth. When the lead animals noticed the green Wyoming game and fish pickup, they didn't stop or panic, but simply turned 90 degrees, not breaking stride, their stream bending away from the road. Joe noted how Sheridan sucked in her breath in absolute awe as the herd drew parallel with the pickup, the bucks, does, and fawns glancing over at her, and then the entire herd accelerated and veered back toward the knoll they had appeared from. "Wow," she said.
"Wow is right," Joe agreed.
"Antelope bore me," Julie said. "There are so many of them." For a moment, he had been concerned that the lead antelope was going to barrel into the passenger door, something that occasionally happened when a pronghorn wasn't paying attention to where he was going. That was all he needed, Joe thought sourly. Another damaged pickup Pope could carp about. That's when the call came over the mutual aid channel.
Joe said, "Would you two please be quiet for a minute?"
While the entire county was sheriff's department jurisdiction, game wardens and highway patrolmen were called on for backup for rural emergencies. Sheridan hushed. Julie did too, but with attitude, crossing her arms in front of her chest and clamping her mouth tight. Joe turned up the volume on the radio. Wendy, the dispatcher, had not turned off her microphone. In the background, there was an anxious voice. "Excuse me, where are you calling from?" Wendy asked the caller.
"I'm on a cell phone. I'm sitting in my car on the side of the highway. You won't believe it."
"Can you describe the situation, sir?"
The cell phone signal ebbed with static. But Joe could clearly hear the caller say,
"There are 3 men in cowboy hats swinging at each other with shovels in the middle of the prairie. I can see them hitting each other out there. It's a bloody mess."
Wendy said, "Can you give me your location, sir?" The caller read off a mile marker on State Highway 130. Joe frowned. The Bighorn Road they had just driven on was also Highway 130. The mile marker was just 2 miles from where they had turned onto the ranch.
"That would be Thunderhead Ranch then, sir?" Wendy asked the caller.
"I guess."
Joe shot a look toward Julie. She had heard and her face was frozen, her eyes wide.
"That's just over the hill," she said.
Joe had a decision to make. He could drive the remaining 5 miles to the ranch headquarters where Julie lived, or take a fork in the road that would deliver him, as well as Sheridan and Julie, to the likely location of an assault in progress.
"I'm taking you home," Joe said, accelerating.
"No," Julie cried. "What if it's someone I know? We've got to stop them."
Joe slowed, his mind racing. He felt it necessary to respond, but did not want to put the girls in danger.
"You sure?"
"Yes, what if it's my dad or one of my uncles?"
He nodded, did a 3-point turn, and took the fork. He snatched the mic from its cradle.
"This is GF-43. I'm about 5 to 10 minutes from the scene."
Wendy said, "You're literally there on the ranch?"
"Affirmative."
There was a beat of silence. "I don't know whether Sheriff McClanahan is going to like that."
Joe and the sheriff did not get along. Joe snorted. "Ask him if he wants me to stand down."
You ask him, Wendy said, completely breaking protocol. As they powered up the two-track, Joe could see that Sheridan and Julie had huddled together.
Can you keep a secret?
Julie whispered, loud enough for Joe to hear.
Of course I can, Sheridan said. You know that. We're best friends.
Julie nodded seriously, as if making up her mind.
You can't tell your parents, Julie said, nodding at Joe.
Sheridan hesitated before answering.
I swear. Swear to God? Julie asked. Come on, Julie, I said, I promise.
Tighten your seatbelts, girls, Joe cautioned. This is going to be bumpy. The scene before them, as they topped the hill, silenced Julie and whatever she was going to tell Sheridan. Below them, on the flat, there were three pickups, each parked haphazardly in the sagebrush, doors wide open. Inside the ring of trucks, three men circled each other warily, raising puffs of dust, an occasional wide swing with a shovel flashing the late afternoon sun. Out on the highway, two sheriff's department SUVs and a highway patrolman turned from the highway onto an access road, their lights flashing. One of the SUVs burped on his siren.
Jesus Christ, McClanahan said over the radio as the vehicles converged on the fight. It's a rodeo out here. There's blood pouring out of them.
Yeehaw, the highway patrolman said sardonically. Joe thought the scene in front of him was epic in implication and ridiculous at the same time. Three adults, two of them practically legends in their own right, so blinded by their fight that they didn't seem to know that a short string of law enforcement vehicles was approaching. And not just any adults, but Arlen, Hank, and Wyatt Scarlett, the scions of the most prominent ranch family in the 12 Sleep Valley. It was as if the figures on Mount Rushmore were headbutting one another. It was darkly fascinating seeing the three of them out there, Joe thought. He was reminded that, in a situation like this, he would always be an outsider looking in. Despite his time in 12 Sleep County, he would never feel quite a part of this scenario, which was rooted so deeply in the valley. The tendrils of the Scarlett family ranch and of the Scarletts themselves reached too deeply, intertwined with too many other people and families to ever completely sort out. Their interaction with the people and history of the area was multi-layered, nuanced, too complicated to ever fully understand. The Scarletts were colorful, ruthless, independent, and eccentric. If newcomers to the area displayed even half of the strange behavior of the Scarletts, Joe was sure they'd have been run out of the state or shunned to the point of cruelty. But the Scarletts were local. They were founders. They were benefactors and philanthropists, despite their eccentricities. It was almost as if longtime residents of the area had declared in unison, yes, they're crazy, but there are lunatics, and we won't have anyone insulting them or judging them harshly who hasn't lived here long enough to understand. Arlen was the oldest brother and the best liked. He was tall with broad shoulders and a mane of silver-white wavy hair that made him look like the state Senate majority floor leader he was. He had a heavy, thrusting jaw and the bulbous spiderweb nose of a drinker. His clear blue eyes looked out from under bushy eyebrows that were black as smears of grease, and he had a soothing, sonorous voice that turned the reading of a diner menu into a performance. Arlen had the gift of remembering names and offspring, and could instantly continue a conversation with a constituent that had been cut off months before. Hank, the middle brother, was smaller than Arlen. He was thin and wiry with a sharp-featured, blade-like face and wore a sweat-stained gray Stetson clamped tight on his head. Joe had never seen Hank without the hat and had no idea if he had hair underneath it. He remembered Vern Dunnigan, the former game warden in the district, warning Joe to stay away from Hank unless he absolutely had the goods on him. Hank Scarlett is the toughest man I've ever met, Vern had said. The scariest, too. Hank had a way of looking coiled up when he stood still,
the way a Brahma bull was calm just before the chute gate opened. Hank was an extremely successful big game guide and outfitter with operations in Wyoming, Alaska, and Kenya. His clients were millionaires, and he was suspected of using less than ethical means to assure kills of trophy animals. Hank had been on Joe's radar screen even before Joe was assigned the Saddle String District, and Hank knew it. All the game wardens knew of Hank. But Joe had never found hard evidence of any wrongdoing. Hank's legend was burnished by rumors and stories, such as when Hank single-handedly packed a 200-pound mountain sheep 12 miles across the Wind River Mountains in a blinding snowstorm, or Hank crash-landing a bush plane with mechanical problems into the middle of a frozen Alaskan lake, rescuing two clients, amputating the leg of one of them while they waited for rescue, and Hank dropping from a tree onto the back of a record bull moose and riding it a quarter of a mile before reaching forward and slitting its throat. Wyatt was the biggest, but the youngest. His face was cherubic, without the sharp angles his brothers had. Everything about Wyatt was soft and round, his cheeks, his nose, the extra flesh around his soft brown eyes. He was in his early 30s. When people within the community talked about the historic Scarlet Ranch or the battling Scarlet Brothers, it was understood they were referring to Arlen and Hank. It was as if Wyatt didn't exist, as if he was as much an embarrassment to the community as he was, no doubt, to the family itself. Joe knew very little about Wyatt, and what he had heard wasn't good. When Wyatt Scarlet was brought up, it was often in hushed tones. Joe was close enough now that he could see Arlen clearly. Arlen was bleeding from a cut on the side of his head, and he shot a glance over his shoulder at the approaching vehicles, which gave an opening to Hank, the middle brother, to swing and hit the back of Arlen's head with the flat of his shovel like a pumpkin on a post. Julie screamed and covered her face with her hands. Joe realized what he was thrusting her into and slammed on his brakes. Julie, I'm going to take you home. No, she sobbed. Just make them stop before my dad and my uncles kill each other. Joe and Sheridan exchanged glances. Sheridan had turned white. She shook her head, not knowing what to say. Joe blew out a breath and continued on. Arlen went down from the blow as the convoy fanned out in the sagebrush and surrounded the brothers. Joe hit his brakes and opened his door, keeping it between him and the Scarlets. As he dug his shotgun out and racked the pump, he heard McClanahan whoop a blast from a siren and say in his new cowboy slang cadence, "Drop the shovels, men, and step back from each other with your hands on your head. Except you, Arlen, you stay down." The officers spilled out of their vehicles, brandishing weapons. The warning seemed to have no effect on Hank, who was standing over Arlen and raising his shovel above his head with two hands, as if about to strike it down on his brother the way a gardener beheads a snake. Joe thought Arlen was a dead man, but Wyatt suddenly drove his shoulder into Hank and sent him sprawling, the shovel flying end over end through the air. "Go!" McClanahan shouted at his men. "Go round him up now!" "Stay here," Joe said to Julie and Sheridan. His daughter cradled Julie in her arms. Julie sobbed, her head down. Joe, holding his shotgun pointed above the fray, stepped around his truck and saw three deputies, including Deputy Mike Reed, rush the three prone Scarlet brothers. Reed was the only deputy Joe considered sane and professional. The others were recent hires by McClanahan and were, to a man, large, mulish, quick with their fists, and just as quick to look away if an altercation involved someone who was a friend of the sheriff's department, or more specifically, McClanahan himself. Arlen simply rolled to his stomach and put his hands behind his back to be cuffed, saying, "Take it easy, boys, take it easy. I'm cooperating." Wyatt, after watching Arlen, did the same, although he looked confused. It took all three deputies to subdue Hank, who continued to curse and kick and swing at them, one blow connecting solidly with Deputy Reed's mouth, which instantly bloomed with bright red blood. Finally, after a pepper spray blast to his eyes, Hank curled up in the dirt, and the deputies managed to cuff his hands behind him and bind his cowboy boots together with flex cuffs. After 2 years as county sheriff, McClanahan still seemed to be somewhat unfinished, which is why he had apparently decided in recent months to assume a new role, that of local character. After trying on and discarding several personas, squinty-eyed gunfighter, law enforcement technocrat, glad-handing politician, McClanahan had decided to aspire to the mantle of good old boy, a stereotype that had served his predecessor Bud Barnum well for 24 years. In the past 6 months, McClanahan had begun to slow his speech pattern and pepper his pronouncements and observations with arcane westernisms. He'd even managed to make his face go slack. His sheriff's crisp gray Stetson had been replaced by a floppy black cowboy hat and his khaki department jacket for a bulky Carhartt ranch coat. Rather than driving the newest sheriff's department vehicle, McClanahan opted for an old county pickup with rust spots on the panels. He bought a blue heeler puppy to occupy the passenger seat and had begun to refer to his 7-acre parcel of land outside the city limits as his ranch. McClanahan squatted down in the middle of the triangle of handcuffed brothers and asked, "Can one of you tell me just what in the hell this is all about?" Joe listened. "Mama's gone," Hank said, his voice hard. "And that son of a bitch there," he nodded toward Arlen, "thinks he's gonna get the ranch." McClanahan said, "What do you mean she's gone? Like she's on a vacation or something?" Hank didn't take his eyes off of Arlen. "Like that son of a bitch killed her and hid the body," he said. "What?" McClanahan said. There was a high, unearthly wail, an airy squeal that seemed to come down from the mountains. The sound made the hairs on Joe's neck stand up. It was Wyatt. The big man was crying. Joe looked over his shoulder at his pickup truck to see if Julie had heard. Luckily, the windows were up and she was still being held by Sheridan. "Mind if I stand up now?" Arlen asked the sheriff. McClanahan thought it over, nodded his assent, and told Deputy Reed to help Arlen up, but to keep him away from Hank. Joe squatted down a few feet from Wyatt. "Are you okay?" Joe asked. "Are you hurt?" Wyatt just continued to sob, his head between his knees, his back heaving, tears spattering the ground between his boots. Joe asked again. Wyatt reached up with his cuffed hands and smeared his tears across his dirty face. "Where's my mom?" Wyatt asked, his words mushy. Joe noticed Wyatt had missing teeth. "Where'd she go?"
"I don't know," Joe said. "She can't be far."
"But Hank says she's gone,"
Joe said. "I'm sure we'll find her." Wyatt's eyes flared, and for a second, Joe thought the man would strike out at him.
"Where's my mom?"
Wyatt howled.
"Pickett!" McClanahan yelled. "What are you doing over there?"
Joe stood uneasily, searching Wyatt's upturned, tragic face for a clue to his behavior.
"Making sure Wyatt's okay," Joe said.
"He's not,"
McClanahan said, and one of the deputies laughed.
"Trust me on that one."
Joe looked at Arlen and Hank. Both brothers were turned toward Wyatt, but neither said anything. They simply stared at their younger brother as if they were observing an embarrassing stranger. Joe walked over to Deputy Reed, who was holding a bandana to his split lip.
"What do you think the deal is with Opal?" Joe asked, out of earshot of the Scarlett brothers.
"Don't know," Reed said, "but I do know that old woman's just too goddamn mean to die."
While Sheriff McClanahan interviewed each of the brothers quietly and individually, Joe concluded that he was no longer needed, and by inadvertently bringing Julie, he had done more harm than good.
"I've got Julie Scarlett, Arlen's daughter, in my truck," Joe told Reed. "I don't want her to see any more. I think I need to get her home to her mother." Joe gestured toward Arlen.
"You mean Hank?" Reed asked.
"No," Joe said. "I mean her dad, Arlen."
Reed squinted. "Arlen isn't her dad."
Joe wasn't sure what to say. He had dropped Julie off before at the big ranch house where she lived with Arlen, her mother, and Opal. As far as Joe knew, Hank lived alone in a hunting lodge on the other side of the ranch.
"What do you mean?" Joe asked.
Reed shrugged.
"When it comes to the Scarletts, nothing is as it seems. Julie and her mother moved out of Hank's place years ago, but from what I understand, Hank is her dad."
Joe wondered if Sheridan knew this, if Julie had told her, or if Reed was mistaken.
"Either way," Joe said, "I think I should get her home."
Reed nodded. "If you see Opal, give us a call."
"I will. Do you really think she's missing?"
Reed scoffed. "Do you really think those men would be out here beating each other with shovels if she was back home baking cookies? The whole damn county has been scared of the day when Opal passed on and those three would start fighting for the ranch. Now it looks like that day has come." As Joe turned toward his truck, he heard McClanahan shout at him,
"Where do you think you're going?"
"To the ranch," Joe said over his shoulder. "It looks like you've got things handled here."
"It's okay," Reed told his boss. "He's got Hank's little girl with him."
"I'll need your statement," McClanahan said. "Sounds like you were one of the last people to see Opal alive."
Joe turned, surprised. He had talked to Opal the day before about charging fishermen access fees. One of the brothers must have told McClanahan that.
"When do you need the statement?"
"Tonight."
Joe thought of Marybeth's last words to him that morning. She asked him to be home on time because she was cooking dinner and wanted to have the whole family there for a change. With her business thriving, that was a rarity. He had promised he would be home.
"Gonna be tomorrow morning?" Joe asked.
The sheriff's face darkened.
"No, it can't. We gotta jump all over this one. What you gotta tell us may help."
Joe looked up. He saw that Julie's head was up, her eyes on her uncles and father. He wanted to get her away from there, and quickly.
"Tonight,"
McClanahan called after him.
"Tonight,"
Joe said, walking away.
He opened the door to his truck and said,
"I'm so sorry you saw this, Julie."
She cried, "Please, just take me home." Chapter 2. On the morning Opal Scarlett vanished, a mud-streaked, green, late-model SUV with Georgia plates pulled off I-80 at exit 214 and into the parking lot of Rip Griffin's truck stop outside Rawlins, Wyoming. The driver left the car running while he climbed out, stretched, and dug through his army duffel in the back seat for a clean shirt. He had been driving all night and all morning, stopping only to fill the tank and buy pork rinds, bottled water, and cashews. The floor of the car was littered with the wrappers. As he walked across the parking lot toward the store, he breathed in deeply and looked around him. It was high and desolate, this country, as if the prairie had been pushed from below the earth way up in the air. He thought of seeing the sign just an hour ago that read Continental Divide, thinking, that's it. Not a single damned tree. The smell in the air was of diesel fumes from the trucks lined up on the far side of the lot, and something sweet that he guessed was sagebrush. Even with the interstate highway humming behind him, there was an immense blanket of quiet off the road. The air was light and thin and the terrain wide open as far as he could see. He felt exposed, like everybody who could see him would know why he was there, what he was up to. He thought of the herds of pronghorn antelope he had seen in the distance as the sun came up, hundreds of them out there, red, brown, and white, glowing when the sun hit them and lit them up. unlike the animals he was used to at home, who survived by hiding in the dark timber and the swamp and moved only at night. These antelopes stood out there in the wide open plains, bold as you please, using the openness and long-range visibility as a defense measure. If you could see them, he thought, they could see you. Hide in plain sight. That was the way out here. He would learn something from that. In the bathroom, he stripped off his greasy sweatshirt, balled it up, and tossed it in a garbage can. He filled the sink with water, splashed his face and rubbed it under his arms, across his chest, and dried off with paper towels. He stared at his reflection in the mirror, liking what he saw, liking it a lot. His blue eyes burned back from shadowed sockets. There were hollows under his sharp cheekbones, and his three-day growth of beard added an edge to his gaunt features that had once been described by the wife of his last hunting client as haunted. He didn't know if that was good or bad, but he didn't forget the word. He tilted his chin up and surveyed his pectorals and liked the clean definition of them, and the blue, green, and red tattoo of a striking water moccasin that stretched from one nipple to the other. The way the head of the snake turned out with an open mouth and dead black eyes always gave him a little thrill. It scared some women, another thing that was all right with him. He pulled the rubber band out of his long brown hair, combed it back with his fingers, and then snapped it back on. With his hair pulled back so tight, it looked as though he wore a skull cap, and his eyes appeared even more piercing. He liked that too. Teeth bared into a half grin, he made his eyes go dead. This was his most fearsome look. He had showed it to the lady who said he seemed haunted, and it had the desired effect. She was terrified, her eyes so wide they looked about to pop out, her mouth forming a perfect little hole. That felt good, to have that kind of power over a rich, stupid lady who shouldn't have been in his hunting camp in the first place. The bathroom door wheezed open and a trucker came in. He was big through the shoulders but had a fleshy face and a big belly. When the trucker saw him standing there at the sink, he started to say something smart-ass, something like, "Doing a little primping, eh?" or "Did you forget your hairspray?" But when their eyes met in the mirror, it was as if the fat man suddenly choked on a piece of meat. All the man did was nod, turn away, and pass behind him for the shelter of a stall. He winked at himself in the mirror, pleased with the effect he had on a man outweighing him by at least 90 pounds, then pulled his new shirt on and walked out of the bathroom. As he passed the counter, which was stacked with displays for all natural amphetamines and cigarette lighters in the shape of cell phones and hand grenades, he asked the bored, washed-out clerk, "Is this the right road to get to the Wyoming State Pan?" "The Pan?" the clerk said, mocking his accent. He was so surprised by her insolence that he didn't know what to say. His first instinct was to reach over the box of beef jerky and pull her tongue out by the roots. "Yeah," she continued, either too empty-headed or jaded to care about how he felt. "This is the exit. Just get back on the road and go over the hill and you'll see it." She gestured vaguely over her head to the south. "You visiting or checking in?" Again, she insulted him. He could feel the rush of blood to his face, feel his fists involuntarily clench. If only she knew what he was capable of, he thought. If only that clerk knew about what had happened to that hunter and his wife back in Mississippi. She wouldn't be doing this. That couple should never have left Atlanta to go hunting in their green SUV. The site of the prison complex, a bunch of low-slung gray buildings sprawled across a sagebrush-choked valley, cooled him down a little. As he passed the sign that read, "No trespassing, all vehicles and individuals are subject to search beyond this point," his mind focused again, his anger venting out like the cack-cack-cack of a pressure cooker releasing steam, the reason for his arrival coming back into prominence. Not that he didn't think about that woman behind the counter, how he could come back later and wait for her in the employee parking lot so that he could break her face and that mouth open with an iron bar. But he had work to do, information to get, and it had been long in planning. He couldn't let her insolence set him back, add an unnecessary complication. That clerk would never know how close she had come to... what? He wasn't sure. He would have just let his rage take over, seen where it took him. One thing he was sure of, she was the luckiest woman in Rawlins, Wyoming. Too bad she didn't know it. The prison was close to the interstate, but a high, rocky ridge separated the two. Every day, thousands of travelers took that interstate going either east or west, and few, if any of them, knew how close they were to a maximum security prison just over the hill, a place filled with murderers, rapists, kidnappers, and other scum of the earth. He had known plenty of ex-cons. Some he'd grown up with, some he'd hired, some he'd gone drink for drink with at a bar. In fact, technically, he was an ex-con, although he didn't feel like one. 5 years in his state pen down south for aggravated assault. He'd spent most of his time observing the makeup of the general population. To a man, they were stupid. Even the ones with some intelligence had a stupid blind spot that later tripped them up. They deserved to go to prison. They didn't think, they just did. They were nature's mistakes, human bowel movements. Prison was too good for most of them, and he'd told a couple of them that right to their faces because he didn't care what they thought of him. He cruised through the parking lot, looking at the cars. Half of the plates were from Wyoming, the rest from all over. He saw a flash of brake lights from a yellow 10-year-old Ford pickup with a camper shell and Wyoming plates. The truck had just pulled in. He parked the SUV 2 rows behind it. While he waited, he emptied all the metal from his pockets into a dirty sock and put it in the glove compartment. The occupants of the truck, an older man wearing red suspenders, and a pear-shaped woman with tight gray curls, finally got out to go inside. They were no doubt the parents or grandparents of some stupid convict, and in a way it was kind of a sweet, sad thing to see. Were they wondering what they could have done differently? Did they ask themselves where they had gone wrong to turn out a son like this, a human bowel movement? But, he said to himself, at least they have family. He took a quick look in the mirror, smiled at his reflection, and followed. The old couple walked so slowly he overtook them at the entrance to the building. The man flinched a bit when he darted in front of them and grabbed the handle to the door. The old man snorted, said, "What in the?" But instead of rushing inside, the man who had driven all night opened the door for them, stepped aside and said, "Let me get this here heavy door for you." The woman looked from her husband to the man and smiled. "Thank you," she said. "My pleasure." While he waited for the old couple to check in at a desk inside the waiting room, he read the notices on the bulletin board. The room was clean and light, built of cinder block painted pale lime green. The check-in desk was on one side of the room, and a row of lockers was on the other. The couple gave their names while the woman in uniform behind the desk found their names in her notebook. The guard handed them a key and told them to remove all metal objects and to put everything in one of the lockers before going through the metal detector. "In order to visit," a sign posted on the bulletin board said, "visitors shall be modestly dressed to be permitted inside. The following will not be allowed: bare midriffs, see-through blouses or shirts, sleeveless shirts, shorts, tube tops, halter tops, extremely tight or revealing clothing, dresses or skirts above the knee, sexually revealing attire." He glanced over at the old couple while they emptied their pockets. The woman seemed flustered. She clucked at her husband, asking him whether he thought her thick old nurse's shoes would be okay. The old man shrugged. She wore a billowy print dress that did little to disguise her bulk. Thick, mottled ankles stuck out below the hem of the dress and looked stuffed into the shoes. Nothing sexually revealing there, he thought, and smiled. Visitors must wear undergarments. Children under the age of 10 may wear shorts and sleeveless shirts. No rubber slippers or flip-flops will be allowed. It took the couple 3 tries to get through the metal detector. First, the old man had to remove his suspenders because of the metal clips. The second time, the woman had to confess that the bra she wore to hold up her massive breasts contained wire. Then the man had to remove his work boots because of the hobnails in the heels. Finally, the guards allowed the old couple through, provided the suspenders be put away in the locker. He watched the old man close his locker door and noted the number, 16. He approached the check-in desk, smiling. "You are?" the guard asked. He said his name. "Give me your ID so I can hold on to it here." He handed his driver's license to her. She looked at it and matched up the photo. "That's quite a name," she said, and the corners of her mouth curled up a fraction. Was she amused? Contemptuous? Flirty?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.